Hallelujah. And now we will proceed to the heart of our service today, the most important part, the food of our soul. So this is the word of God. Amen. So let's give a clap offering to the Lord, to the life of our Savior today. Sister Bethel, please.
Praise the Lord. The holy presence of the Lord.
Amen.
He is refreshed. Amen. God is refreshed because you are taking from Him. Amen.
Amen.
And let me hear say, Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So thank you, Jesus. I request all the heads bow down for a little bit. We're going to pray for the guidance of the Holy Spirit.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord, for this day, that we will have again the privilege, Lord God, to hear your word and to have a food, Lord God, that you have given us today. Let your food, Lord God, have names on it. On top of it are every names that are in this place and that all the people that will watch this in the name of Jesus. Let every word, Lord God, from you be personal enough to each and every one of us and be powerful enough, authoritative, Lord God, simple and understandable, Lord God, so that we may live, Lord God, according to your word, Father God.
Yes,
thank you, Jesus, for this day, Father God, that you have woken us up, given us strength, Father, and given us privilege to serve you again, to worship you, Father God. We pray that you would guide us in your word, Father God. We pray that you will illuminate, Lord God, your word, and it will rhema in each and every one of us, Father God, so that we may carry it, Lord God, we may live in it, Father God, to the end of the days that we are here on earth. Father in heaven, we thank you in the mighty name of Jesus. Use your servant, Lord, and let her disappear in this place, and you will be manifested, Lord God. You will be seen, you will be glorified, your name will be lifted up in the mighty name. Praise the Lord.
I can give all my breath to praise and worship God. But I cannot do this by myself. It is the grace of God. Amen. That is given to us to praise Him, to worship Him, and to use everything that we have for Him who has given us all. Amen. So we will continue with our series. This is the part three and the last part of the series that we are on. We are in the growing Christian journey. So the title of our series is Where Am I Now in My Journey with God? If you are confused, where are you now in your journey with God? Because we are all individually having a journey and growing in Christ, growing with our relationship personally with God. Amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. So we are going to review a little bit because we are on the last part of our series. This is a fellowship which is beginning with God, close to God, and God-centered, and these people are only having fellowship with God. They are these are the people who haven't received yet Jesus Christ, the ancient people. I forgot the first term. These people, the exploring God people, and the beginning with God, they realize the truth, this new of truth, they realize that there is a need for them of a Savior, and there is only one Savior, it is Jesus Christ. This beginning with God, once they accepted Jesus Christ, they are now beginning with God, and automatically when you accepted Jesus Christ, made Him as your Lord and Savior, you are in the Lordship of Christ, because had not Jesus is not your Lord, you are not saved. If you are on your way, your own way, you're driving your own way, you are not saved. If not Jesus, the Lord of your life, you are still here exploring God. Maybe somebody had invited you here, but this is a perfect
with God. And automatically, it will shock you, you are in the Lordship. This is not a pattern that, oh, I am a 10-year-old Christian or 20 years in my Christian life, I'm already in the Lordship. We can decrease and we can stay in the Lordship in the God-centered part, the fourth group of people. There are four groups of people in the church attending. Exploring God, beginning with God, close to God, and God-centered. This beginning with God people and the close to God people, they understood that the Word of God, God's Word, is the final authority of their life, which they are following, the Bible. Amen? And this close to God and God-centered people, they understood that the principle of giving, that it is not only giving money, it is giving yourself. It is giving your everything to the one who gave you everything.
Amen.
Giving. This is not only money. Not only talking about money. It is your time, your talent, your effort, your everything that God has given you. The principle of giving. This close to God and God-centered people understood this very well. Okay? We can relate this as we are in school. The exploring people, exploring God people are like kindergartens. They can study, sing, and all day long study alphabets, but immediately they will forget. Because we are in a series in the parable of the sowers. These are that the word of God is thrown on the wayside, the kindergarten people. When you ask them, what have you learned today, they will tell you, I forget. Amen. And this one, the elementary people, the beginning with God, once you accept Jesus Christ, you are getting hungry of the Word of God. You are getting thirsty of the water of the Word. Amen. So these are the elementary people. They are studying little by little. And the close to God people, they are the secondary students. They are a little bit of algebra, bookkeeping, accounting, you know, a little bit hard, a little bit meaty, as the Word of God says. This one is the milk, they are taking the milk. This one are solid food already. And the God-centered people are the ones who are in the college level. They are studying, they are taking masteral, they are taking mission classes or the discipleship higher classes. They are still continuing with God, because our journey with God is from our salvation unto eternity. You will not wait until you die that you will receive your salvation in eternity. Once you accept Jesus Christ, your journey in eternity starts now. Amen? So we can also compare them in friendship. These people, the exploring God people, are not yet a friend of God. The beginning with God people, once they accept Jesus Christ, they are now a friend of God. And the close to God people, they are BFFs. Best friends, amen. BFFs. And the God-centered people, these are the people, we can relate them, which is higher in friendship. These are the not BFF anymore, because we will say BFF, something like that. But these are like a husband and wife relationship. Remember, we are the bride of Christ. So that is the husband and wife relationship, that you are sharing everything together, even your food. You will ask, Lord, will I eat this? Even your dress, Lord, what will I wear today? Is it pleasing? Amen. Everything you will ask to your spouse. God-centered people. In anyways, we are on the fourth journey. We are on the Lordship. Lordship. Meaning everything. He is the author of your day. Everything you will enthrone to Him, everything you will ask Him, like husband and wives. Everything. Okay. Now, these are the last week, last week, we talked about
the thorns of life that choke the word so that it will not be fruitful on our hearts. These are the devil's strategy, that the word of God will, he will create thorns, the thorns of life, the cares of this life, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desire of other things. So the enemy has a strategy that the desire and the lust, he uses it interchangeably. You have a desire for something, but it is, if it's not a desire for God, to glorify God, it's a lust for something. You get me? Interchangeably. So the devil is he's using the desire and the lust interchangeably. So we use the desire when Jesus told his disciple, and he's also telling us today, that his only desire is that for those who has given him by the Father has given him, they will be where he is. That is his greatest desire. Amen. Can you tell your neighbor, you are beautiful today, you are handsome today? The good ground is our hearts. If the ground is not good, the seed will not go inside and will not bear fruit. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, Luke chapter 8, verse 15. But that on the good ground, we are talking about the good ground, but that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart. So the good ground is an honest and a good heart. The good ground which the parable of the sower is talking about is our hearts. Amen. So it has to be a good heart so that it will bear fruit. Now we will explain later the good heart. Having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. In the other gospel, it says 30, 60, and 100 fold. Now, every one of us wants to bear fruit. Amen.
Amen.
Every one of us wants to have 100 folds. Not only 30, not only 60, but we want the seed of the Word of God to produce in our life 100 folds and more.
Amen.
Amen. Now, there is a parallel verse with this good ground. We will explain the good heart. Now, you are the recipient of the Word of God. Matthew chapter 13, verse 10 to 15. ESV version, then the disciples came and said to him, why do you speak to them in parables? Why there are many people attending church and doesn't understand what the speaker is talking about? And Jesus answered them, to you it is given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven. Who accepted Jesus Christ? Can you raise your hands? That is He your Lord? Is He your Lord? Amen.
Amen.
So Jesus is talking to you. To you it is given to know the secrets of the kingdom of God. To you. But to them it has not been given. Who are these to them? The exploring God people. Those who has not yet accepted Jesus Christ, they will not understand the words in our Bible, because the words in it are spiritual. and life will not talk to the dead people. Because Jesus is life. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Those who has not yet accepted Jesus Christ has no life. They are still dead. Amen. So they will not understand the Bible, because what is inside the Bible is spirit and it is life. But to them it has not been given. For to the one who has, more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is why I speak to them in parables, because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. Indeed, in their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled that says, you will indeed hear but never understand. You will indeed see but never perceive. For these people's heart has grown dull. Can you magnify that verse? For these people's hearts has grown dull. What is that? They make their hearts hard. What happened? See, that the heart that will bear fruit is the heart who is a good ground, the good heart. Amen. The good heart. Later I will tell you what constitutes a good heart. But these people who doesn't bear fruit are the ones who have a dull heart, a hard heart. And this is the cost of having a hard heart, when you harden your hearts to receive the word. And with their ears, they can barely hear, meaning they cannot hear properly from the Lord. And their eyes, they have closed. When you have hardened your hearts, you cannot hear from the Lord. Even you can understand, you can read, you cannot hear from the Lord. And their eyes, they have closed. It is not God that closed their eyes, but they who have hardened their hearts, they have closed their eyes from understanding the word. Lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I will heal them. There is a heart problem. That's why we are not bearing fruit. Because the Luke 8 chapter 15 said, but on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, and it bears fruit. The good heart bears fruit. Who doesn't bear fruit? Those who have a dull heart. A dull heart is a hard heart. When you see in the natural, when you plant and the soil is hard and you put the seed will stay on top. And the birds of the air will take the seed when the soil is hard. But when the soil is plowed, the soil is good. When you put the seed, it will go inside, and after a few days or a few weeks, it will spring up. And after a few years, it will bear fruit. When the soil, our hearts is good. Our hearts is good. Amen. There is a heart problem for the people who doesn't bear fruit. They cannot receive revelation. Sometimes we will say, I am not blessed. I am not blessed like before. Because we have hardened our hearts. This is what the Word of God says. Now, what constitutes a good heart? Let's see Ezekiel chapter 36, 26 to 27. This is where we all started when we received Christ. Amen. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. You will not walk alone in his statutes. God, this is grace. If you see this, this is grace. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you. God will cause you to follow his statutes. You will not say, God, I will follow your statutes. You will not say like Peter, God, I love you. I will not leave you nor forsake you. I will not renounce you. But this is grace. I will put my spirit. It is by grace we have been saved through faith. And God will put His spirit in you. And cause you. Who will cause you? God will cause you to walk in His statutes. God will cause you. Not you will cause yourself to walk in my statutes. And He, God, He shall keep my, and you shall keep my judgment and do them. See, it is all together. God will cause you to keep His statutes and do them. God will cause you. You will not initiate by yourself. There is something that God has given you to do everything for His glory. See, we all started in a heart of flesh with a soft heart. When we receive Jesus Christ, we all have a soft heart. But what happens on our journey? The parable of the sower is the seed, you know, was thrown away and put on a stony ground or with the thorns and then with a good soil. So this is talking about what happens on our journey with God. Why this heart of flesh became a hard heart. That's why the seed will not bear fruit. This is a heart problem. Now, we are unveiling this so that we all know what causes the seed of the Word of God to not bear fruit in our hearts. So God has given us the secrets of the kingdom of God so that we may know. We may know what chokes the Word and what makes the Word unfruitful in our lives. We hear the Word, amen? We hear words every day. We hear words every Friday also, and we believe them. And suddenly, when persecution comes, when tribulation comes, when famine comes, when everything that you have, your life experiences, everything falls out on you, like the Word falls out on you, everything you have forgotten. What happened? We are offended. We are offended. We are wounded on what happens to us. And so we say, that's what hardened our hearts. So we say, I will never let this happen to me again. And so we harden our hearts. I will not let this happen to me again. I have a broken family. I will not let this happen to me again. So we harden our hearts. So we are praying for one girl, and this girl says, no, I don't like you. And we harden our hearts. I will not pursue any girl anymore because nobody will like me. We harden our hearts. We don't believe anymore with the Word of God that we heard. So this is what causes to harden our hearts. The tribulations, the persecution come, the cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, and our desires for other things. This is what causes the Word to get choked and not be fruitful. So we are amazed. God, why this person has so much revelation? Why this person understand the Word easily than me? So we dare to compare. Now God is telling you the problem. We harden our hearts to receive the Word because of our experiences. Our experiences that make us wounded, and we say to ourselves, I will never let this happen to me again. Amen. What constitutes a good heart? One, a humble heart. Isaiah 57 verse 15. For thus saith the high and lofty one that inhabiteth eternity, whose name is holy, I dwell, God dwells, in the high and holy place. Where God dwells? In the high and holy place. with him also, God dwells also with him who that is of a contrite and a humble spirit, a humble heart. Okay, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the hearts of the contrite ones. So God dwells in a humble heart. Now, what is the meaning of humble? Humble means to prostrate yourself, to bow down, to get low. Do you know that the way up to the kingdom is to get low? You want to start to serve God? You want to start, oh, I want to be a worship leader. Already, I just came from the church. I just came by and I want to be a worship leader. I want to be a preacher because I am preaching in my church. No, the way to the kingdom to get up is to start with the low road. Amen?
Amen.
Start with the low road. So take the low road, start with a small responsibility first. When God finds you faithful in small things, He will promote you. For promotion doesn't come from the east and from the west, but it comes from God. Promotion comes from God. In case you don't know that you are promoted, it is the grace of God that has given to you. Amen. In case you don't know that you have a job, new job right now, it is God who has given it to you. Amen. Psalms 10 verse 17, it says, Lord, thou hast heard the desire of the humble, thou will prepare thy heart. Thou will cause thine ear to hear. So why God will prepare our hearts, the hearts of the humble? God has heard the desire of the humble and He will prepare their heart and will cause them to hear. Why will God prepare your heart, the humble heart? So that you will hear the word of God. God is preparing our hearts in this tribulation, in this persecution, whatever is happening to you. God is just plowing your heart so that it will be ready to receive the word that will be given to you and it will bear fruit.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Okay, God prepares our hearts. What is the opposite of humble? Prideful, right? Prideful. Do you know why many people couldn't receive or understand the mysteries? Because sometimes we thought we know it all. Sometimes we thought we know everything, so we could not learn anything. Do you know that even the poorest sermon, for example, somebody will stand here and you don't like him or her, even his or her poorest sermon, you can take something from it. You can learn something from it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So if the person is not teachable, he or she always interrupts, don't want to listen, insisting their opinions and on their or their sides, this person is humble or not. You're scared to answer it. No, right? It is he or she is not humble. If a person is not teachable, he or she is not good for the kingdom of God. Only the good recipient, the good heart, will be good for the kingdom. So we start on a no road. Let us be like one who wants to be hungry all the time, who are hungry all the time, who wants to receive every time. Because as you take, more will be given to you. Amen? So God has humbled me for many years of my experiences before. You know that I am here before. If you know me before, you will not like me. God has humbled me so much. Amen. First what happens to me is God took our possession. God took our possession. Why? Because mine replaces his space in
her pillow full of money. But God took it all away. Amen? And second thing, God took me, took all the people that I love the most. God said, if you love your husband, your children, your parents above me, you are not worthy of me. So God took them all away. Third thing that he took away from me, it's like the story of Job, but that not that intense. That because I don't have sheep, I don't have cows, you know, I don't have that possession like Job have. But God has taken away my integrity. When I was working in Singapore, and many of you don't know me, my history was in Singapore. I am forced to work as a prostitute there because I have no money to feed my children. God has taken away my integrity. Why did he do that? So that when people see me and they look at me and they watch me on YouTube, they will say, it has to be God that did this. And God receives all the glory. Amen. God will do that so that he can use you mightily. You will only depend on him. Your world will not go around somebody else's or on the things. Your world will not go around, or your the center of your world is not the things, but it is him that is the center of your life. Amen. So I learned in my life, I cannot love anybody or something else more than God because he will take it away from me. So I am scared to love anybody more than him. But why we love? Later I will tell you why we love. Okay. So God does those things so he can receive all the glory. To seek his righteousness first, and to deny myself and take up my cross and follow him. So what does the cross represent? The cross represents everything that is happening to you today. Can you still worship God?
Amen.
Can you still worship God even though those things are happening to you today?
Amen.
Amen. Luke 22 verse 42 says, Father, if you are willing, remove this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. Whatever happens, I like the song that Jesus, I need you every moment, I need you. Christ before me, Christ behind me. Wherever I fall, Christ is there to catch me.
Amen.
So you will not fear.
Amen.
Amen. Glory. Glory to you, Father. So we must keep our hearts humble despite what is happening to our lives. What God wants to see, can you still worship me? Can you still serve me? Even what's happening to you today. Amen.
Amen.
1 Peter says, 5 verse 6 to 7 says, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you. How can he exalt you if you have all these cares? Cast all your cares on him because he cares for you.
Amen.
Amen. Number 2, what constitutes a good heart? 2, a holy heart. Isaiah again, 57 verse 15, for thus says the high and lofty, lofty is lifted up, the high and lifted one that inhabited eternity, whose name is holy, I dwell in a high and holy place, with him also that is of a contrite and humble spirit. First is a humble heart. Second is a holy heart. A good ground is a humble heart. A good ground is a holy heart. Now, what is holy? That's what we have tackled the last week. Pastor said, holy is not a complicated thing. Holy is a very simple word. Holy means separated, set apart. See, God is set apart. Can you measure the gap which we have in God? But God made it possible for us to connect through Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
So God, because there are people which are not holy, so He is separated because He is holy. Yes, He is holy. But whoever accepts Jesus, the holiness is imputed, the righteousness is imputed. What is imputed? Just like what you are, just like you are when you accepted Him, He will put on you the robe of righteousness that makes you clean, that makes the Father see Jesus in you, not you.
Amen.
Okay. Holy is a simple word meaning set apart or separated from. If we think, because we think, and most people think that holy means sinless. Holy means perfect. Doesn't mean we think that holy means sinless and perfect. No, holy means set apart. Now you will understand this. We think that holy means sinless and perfect, and God is. God is sinless, God is perfect. He is, no doubt in that. But that's not the meaning of holy. Holy means set apart. Leviticus 20 verse 26, you shall be holy to me, for I the Lord am holy and have separated you from the peoples that you should be mine. So I will be your God and you will be my people. I separated you from this world. Okay? If what holy means is sinless and perfect, we have a problem in this verse, 1 Peter 1:15. But as He who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. You also be sinless, you also be perfect in all your conduct. What is all your conduct? In all that you do, in all that you say, in all that you think. That if the holy means sinless and perfect, 1 Peter says, but as He who called you is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct. Since it is written, you shall be holy, for I am holy. Holy means set apart. For us, it means set apart from the conduct of this fallen world. You act differently from the fallen world. You speak, you do, you decide differently from this world. You doesn't have to have the same decision, the same doings, the same speech. Because God has separated you to become His people. You have different language. You have different moves. You have different thinking from this world. Amen?
Amen.
Okay. The thoughts we dwell on becomes the thought of the heart. Matthew 15:18-19 says, what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and that this defiles a person. For out of the heart comes evil thoughts. See, heart can think. Evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, slander. These are what we call last week the appearance, all appearances of evil. So this is what the heart can think of this. If we allow these evil thoughts dwell on our hearts, on our minds, if we meditate it, it will become the thoughts of the heart. And when it becomes the thought of the heart, we will speak it and we will make it into action. Amen.
Amen.
So in Luke chapter 6:45, And this is in our Greek Bible. A good man brings forth good from the good treasure. There is treasure in our hearts that we allow to get in our hearts. A good man brings forth good from the good treasure that is in his heart, and the evil man brings out evil from the evil treasure that is in his heart. For the lips speak from the fullness of the heart. So, and you cannot tell me that it is a joke. Because that is what's from your heart. When you speak it, that's what comes from your heart. Even if it's joke. James 4 verse 7. Okay, how can we drive these evil thoughts? These evil thoughts are, James 4 verse 7 says, submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil. These are devils, as we discussed before. This anger, rage, these evil thoughts, these are the devils. That causes us to have thorns and choke the word, and they took the word from our hearts. Okay. Submit yourselves therefore to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. We can resist. We can cast out these evil thoughts. Amen?
Amen.
Number three. This is my last point. What constitutes a good heart? What makes our heart what makes the heart good, or how you can tell that the heart is good? The heart, number three, is a heavenly heart. Isaiah 57:15, for thus says the one who is high and lifted up, who inhabits eternity, heavenly. Eternity, whose name is holy. First is a humble heart. A good heart is a humble heart. Second, a good heart is a holy heart. And third, a good heart is a heavenly heart. I dwell in the high and holy place. This is a place. Amen. Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. Is a temple a place or no? It is a place. God dwells in a high and holy place. And what is the way high to the kingdom is being low. Being humble. Okay. To revive the spirit of the lowly and to revive the heart of the contrite. So, this is what a heavenly heart. When we receive grace, we have eternal life. Amen. Now, we became a spirit being. We became a heavenly being. A heavenly heart. We are talking about heavenly heart. When we receive the grace of God, we receive Jesus, we receive eternal life. We become being that will live forever. We become a spirit being. This place, this earth is not our home. We are just passers-by. So when you are a passers-by, do you care about all these things that you will just leave after the moment? No. A heavenly heart. What is written in the Bible are eternal words. If we read them in temporal mindset, we will not understand the mystery of the kingdom. But if we have a heavenly heart, or we think of heavenly things while we read on the scripture and read them with a heavenly heart, then we will understand it. I'll give you a verse to back up that. 2 Corinthians 4 verse 18. While we look not at the things which are seen, brothers and sisters, what do you see? What do you see are temporary things. Amen. You see your circumstances, you see what's happening to you today. Those are temporary things.
Amen.
But at the things, while we look at, not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Now, what do you see? Those that you see now are temporary things. Meaning, it will come to pass because you are passers by in this earth. Amen. Did you get me?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Example, when you're riding a boat, the seaside, when you're riding a boat, the sea or river, who among you is scared of riding a boat? So when you ride a boat, some will vomit, some will throw up. Amen? Because the sea is wavering. The sea is not stable. But when you look at the horizon, when you look straight, like when you are riding bike, when you look down, you will fall. When you look at the moment where you are in, you will fall. But if you look at the horizon, which are constant, you will become, you will feel stable. You will feel at ease because that horizon is not moving. Amen. Now, who do you set your mind to? Jesus is that horizon. If you put your eyes on Jesus, you will not waver. You will not be shaken. You are immovable. None of these things will move me.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Romans 8:31. I just want to read scripture because I want to talk, I want to plant heavenly things on your mind today. So you will dwell in it. You will meditate on it. Okay? I will plant Romans 8:31 on your hearts today. This is not my word. This is God's word. And God's word will make His word able what He is proposed into your heart. What He proposed the word to happen to your life today. Amen. Romans 8:31. If God is for us, who can be against us? It doesn't matter who is against us, because God is for us. Amen.
Amen.
And He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all. The heaven's delight. The heaven's great possession. God has given Him to show you how much He loves you.
Amen.
The heaven's greatest possession. All that heaven has, He caused Him to die in behalf or to die as you.
Amen.
The heaven's greatest possession, which is Jesus Christ. God has caused Him, and He said, I will. This is how can I show I love you. For God so loved the world that He gave us His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal, everlasting life. God has caused, did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up all for us all. But gave Him up for us all. How will He not also with Him graciously give us all things? If God has given the greatest possession of heaven to us, and He is in you today, how much more those small things? How much more those small things? If you just know how much God loves you by not sparing His Son for you. Amen. I'm about to finish 2 pages more. Hallelujah. Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn you? If the judge has already sentenced you for acquittal, who can sentence you another one? Amen. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, Christ Jesus not only died for you, God, Christ Jesus has raised for you. For what? Who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Now do you have fear? Jesus is there, died for your place. And Jesus lived for you to be in you. And now Jesus is in heaven interceding, praying for you so that you may do His will. And His grace will empower you. Hallelujah. Who shall separate, this is beautiful, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, this is what I'm telling you. Are you still willing to serve Him? Do you still can serve Him even what in spite of what's happening to you today? Shall tribulation separate you from the love of Christ? Shall distress, shall persecution or famine, nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. How can we become conquerors? Because God loves us. This is heavenly things that we are talking about. So that you will forget about yourself. Because Christ loves you. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come. This is what I'm telling you. Verse 10 to 13. I will end in this, but before that, I want to tell this: there is no fear in love. But 1 John 4:16-19. So we have come to know and believe. Who among you know that you are loved by God? Who among you know that you are loved by God? Can you raise your hand? Who among you believes that God loves you?
Amen.
Amen. That's good. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, I'll read you the scripture. It is not enough to know only that God loves us. We must believe it. Like a husband and wife, when your wife or husband is asking you, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Every time, every day, every moment, they ask you, do you love me? Because they don't believe. They just know, I know you love me, but do you love me? They don't believe. This is the same with God. You have to believe that God loves you. The love that God has for us. God is love, and whoever abides in love abides in God, and God abides in Him. By this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment, because as He is, so also are we in this world. As Jesus is a conqueror, so also are we. As Jesus overcomes, so also are we. As Jesus is, so are we. Okay, for fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not been perfected in love. We love because He first loved us. Do you love God with all of your heart, all of your strength? Do you love your neighbor as yourself? No! You love because God loves you first! We love because God loves us first. How can we love? Because God has given us love. So if you have fear of losing husband, fear of losing daughter or children, fear of losing your job, fear of anything, fear of judgment, any kind of fear, the love of God has not been perfected in you.
Amen.
If you have fear, the love of God is not yet perfected. Because Christ before you, Christ behind you. Who can separate us from the love of Christ? Nothing. What are you fear? What do you fear right now? Okay. I want to tell you one story. This is awkward. This will be awkward in your thinking. Because God told that our thinking must be separated from the thinking of this world. Amen?
Amen.
So I want to tell you a story, and maybe this story will be awkward. Who among you know that the preacher's life is an open book for every people? Do you know that? So if you want to be a preacher, your life is like a cinema. Amen. You have nothing to hide. You cannot hide anything. So I got this when my son has a birthday. Many of you know this. But this is a perfect example of the what holy means. That you're thinking this holiness is given to us by God. Amen. That your thinking is separated from the world. That what you do is different from what the world did. The reaction that you did is different from what the reaction of this world does. Amen. So my son has birthday September 5. That was 2002. He is 15, I think. 15 years old. So my son is 15 years old, and I saw in the Facebook somebody messaged there that calling him also son. Happy birthday, son. And I wonder who is this person who call my son son. Amen. So I added her on Facebook and I chatted with her. And I saw the photos. This person is the living partner of my husband. So I'm talking to her, and I evangelized to her. So I told her, do you know that I cannot talk to you if God doesn't make me whole? If God doesn't change my heart, I cannot talk to you today. But I want to thank God. Because God has taken away my burden, knowing that you treat my son as your own son.
Amen.
Hey! Yeah. Hallelujah! This is not the reaction of the world. The reaction of the world will tell, he or she will get, I will be get angry. But the love of God is perfected in my heart. That I have no place for that anger.
Amen.
I have no place for that reaction. Amen? Because the love of God has to flow to her. My God loves her. My God loves him. And this is what we have to do. God loves every person, even your enemies. For God so loved the world. And that love has to flow. Jesus died for them also.
Amen.
Glory to God. Give praise to the Lord. Hallelujah. Now we are praying for the baby of this girl. Because she had a situation that is every 8 months, she gave birth every 8 months. So I got a new, I don't know if it's son or baby, but I treated that as mine also. Amen.
Isaiah 55 verse 10 to 13. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed. I want you to hear this. Giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word. We are talking, I'm wrapping up the series. We are talking about the Word of God, a good heart, and what constitutes a good heart. Amen? We talked about what causes the Word to not be fruitful in our hearts. And so we will wrap this up for this verse. So shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. This is God saying this. The word that goes out from my mouth, it shall not His word to you today, and it will become successful as you make your heart your heart a good soil, a good ground. Amen. For you shall go out in joy and be led for
in threes, clapping their hands, you know? Of the fields shall clap, the trees of the field shall clap their hands. So we talked about the typology before, the parabolic language of the Bible. These trees are you, rejoicing, clapping their hands. How did we know? Psalms 1 verse 3, he is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. You are the tree. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress. Instead of the thorn, we talk about thorns, shall come up the light cypress. Instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle. And it shall make a name for the Lord, an everlasting sign that shall not be cut off. What does it mean? I will end up with this. This just means, do you know that cypress trees, these are the tallest trees in America. Do you know that cypress trees loves water? Water represents the Word of God by the washing of the water of the Word of God. Okay, what this verse means. My word will produce fruit if you keep your heart right. I'll take care of the thorns, and you will be a cypress tree who loves my word. Every head bowed down, every eye closed. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word, Lord God, that you have caused this word to illuminate in us, Father. Father, we want to ask you, Lord. I want you to meditate on this. You ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, what are you telling me right now? What are you saying to me through this word? Am I prideful, Lord? Is there any thorns that choke the word in me? Is my heart not a good soil? Lord, if that is so, plow my heart, Lord. If that is so, Lord, I humble before you. Forgive me, Lord. I kneel down before you. I humble before you, Lord God. Forgive me for that thing that I did, Lord God, for the thorns, for the cares of this life, for the deceitfulness of the riches, for my desire for other things, and for not having a good soil. For harden my heart for the experiences that I have. Lord, I thank you for plowing my heart again, for my heart to receive your word today. I thank you so much, Lord, because you have made my heart ready to receive your word and revelation. You have made my heart ready for you making this seed fruitful to my heart. I want you to meditate these words. Lord, I want to thank you for plowing my heart, because you are preparing me for a greater ministry. Lord, I thank you for preparing my heart, for you are preparing me for a greater mission. Lord, I thank you for plowing my heart, for you are preparing my heart to be humble. Lord, I'm thanking you for plowing
Church, we are in the last service of Sister Rogel. We are already in the level of lordship. This situation or position that we are in, this is a very, very heavy responsibility. Amen.
Amen.
Lordship. But what comes first in your mind when the word says lordship? Meaning you have a master. Before in the old life, you have a master. And you know who it is, who he was. Right now, when you receive the Lord Jesus Christ, you have a new master. And that is our Lord Jesus Christ. But obedience is being required. If you allow Jesus, if you have a new master, obedience is required. Amen. The Bible says in Luke 6:6, why do you call me Lord, Lord, if you do not do what I say? Sa Tagalog yun, Lord, huwag tawagin Panginoon. Pag pinatawag ng Panginoon, pag hindi mo sinusunod, ang ating sinasabi. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, if you do what I say? This is very, very heavy responsibility. Matthew 17:21 says that anyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only those who do the will of my Father who is in heaven. So we can see that in these verses, in this teaching that we are right now, we have to heard. We need to surrender everything for the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Are you willing to surrender everything for the Lord?
Amen.
I will ask you four different questions. Are there areas in your life that you have not yet submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ? Is there any area of your life? In all areas.
Amen.
Is there anything that you have not yet submitted in the Lordship of Jesus Christ? You can answer this in your own personal life, your personal meditation. Ask the Lord, Lord, is there anything in my life that is not yet submitted to you? Being my Lord. Number two, are your finances submitted in the Lordship of Jesus Christ? Amen?
Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Is your time submitted in the Lordship of Jesus? Our time. For example, when we change the time of our service, we'll make it 6 a.m. in the morning. Are you still willing to come for church?
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. I'm preparing you for something. Anything. Because we are going to make a big leap. Leap of faith. That is a step. It's a leap of faith for this church. And we are, I can see you now, we are like 99% full. Because some of our sisters and brothers are now standing in their space. We're going to, you know, the Lord has just said, you have to expand. You have to move. And you have to obey Him in order for a brighter and bigger ministry. So today, I'm going to challenge everyone. Today is the last day of our worship service in this area. And next Friday, we're moving to a bigger, spacious place. The area has been prepared for us. We have the stage, we have the locker room, and we have a good space there. And after our service, we have space for Bible study outside. And I'm going to challenge you, church, that this is not only your pastor is responsible for this one. The responsibility lies on all of you, all the leaders. And I don't want to give extra, like for example, extra requirement in the financial aspect of our life. Well, I want you to just follow the command of the Lord Jesus Christ. Just give your time and your offering. Then the church will just continue. No need for plans, no need for extra money to be given to the church. just give what is due to the Lord because it is for Him. I would like to teach you about giving today because we're going to give for the Lord and in the new area that we're going to transfer the amount or the fee, the rent is not the same in this place. You have to, to face another challenge. But I believe this challenge will be met by the Lord, not me, not the leaders, not Sister Judith, not any one of you, but it will be met by the financial, the wealthy God, the rich God, who is our God.
Amen.
Amen. And we, His people, we need to, to be a steward for Him. So God wants His people to be prosperous. Amen. God wants all of us to be prosperous. And prosperity is included in the gospel. In John 10:10, what it says, that if not come except to steal, does not come except to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But I have come, who says this? Jesus Christ said, that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly. Abundant. Not only in our salvation, but only in everything, in all aspects of our lives. God wants us to be abundant or prosperous. For you know that the grace of Lord Jesus Christ, that though He was rich, Jesus Christ is rich, He's the Son of God, He's in heaven. He became poor, yet for your sakes, He became poor. That you through His poverty may become rich. So Jesus Christ was born in a manger, He was born in a poor family, He was born in a very, very lowly family. He was poor. What is the meaning of that? Because God wants you to become rich, prosperous in all things. So we have needs in this world. We have physical needs, we have financial needs, and we have all kinds of needs, right? We have all the needs. But there is a key to prosperity. What is the key to prosperity in the business that belongs to God, the church? You call it the business, brother Daniel's calling it business. If you are going to invest in a business, the best business that you're going to invest is in God's business.
Amen.
Amen. Because when you invest in the world, you may lose your money. If you invest in stocks, you lose your money. If you invest in the world, in God, there is a big, big return of your money. Amen?
Amen.
And God wants us to make a decision in this. I would like to tell you that giving is the key to prosperity.
Amen.
Giving is the key to prosperity. When you open your hands, when your hands is open like this, open to give. Open to give to your neighbor, to your brother, to your sisters. Open to give to the church. When God will, when your mind is open, when the blessing will be poured out, you will catch the blessing.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. If your hand is open. But if your hand is closed, and you give your money like this, your hands like this, with the blessing will be poured out, you cannot catch any blessing.
Amen.
Amen. So it's better to give. Give. Hands open, then you receive the blessing.
Yes.
I would like to tell you very, very important thing. We have tithe and offering. We have the tithing, and we have the offering. What is the difference of these two? Tithing, this is the command of God in Genesis. Before the law was given, Abraham tithed to Melchizedek, and he gave tithe of all that he has. So 10% tithing, 10, the meaning of tithing is 10, the 10 of all that you have. For example, if you're receiving a salary of 15,000, and 10% of it is 1,500, that is the requirement of God for you. It is not a choice. It is not a choice if I give or not. This is God's. You have to give it to Him, 10% of your being, of your increase. Amen?
Amen?
Are you understanding what is tithe? Tithe is a tenth of all that you have.
Amen.
That's why the Bible says in Malachi, you are robbing me. Why? Because the tenth that belongs to the Lord you are running to him, and you're feeding it to your children. You're giving it to the church, to some people. So you're giving the money that is you rob from God, and you give your children to your family. Do not fend your family from the money that you rob. You rob it. You're robbing God, 10% of it. So if you have, for example, if I have 1,000 in my hand right now, and I give to Sister Judith, I'll give you 1,000. But at the time that you're going to pay me, you have to pay me 100 only. 10% I will give. That is mine. Okay? So in the time that that she will pay me, she must have paid me 1,000. But I only require the 10 of it. Like 100. But Sister Judith did not pay me the 100 that she's supposed to be given to me. That is mine. The rest is yours. 90% is yours. Just give me 100. That is for me. But if she don't give me the 100 dirhams, she is robbing me with the money that belongs to me. It's the same with the Lord. It's the same with God. If you are not giving a tenth of all that we have, of our salary, we are robbing God. And that's a very, very tragic. The Bible says, the devourer is ready to devour your crops. To be devouring all the blessings for you. I think that this is the command. The blessing will start when you give for your offering. For example, you give your offering after the tithe. When you give, if your salary is 10,000, you give 1,000 for the tithe, then when you give more, that is your offering.
Amen.
But if you give less, for example, you give 800 for the Lord, and you offer 100, that is part of the tithe. You still don't have the offer.
Amen.
And still the blessing is not flowing. Why? Because it is still the offering. No, in the tithe. Offering is giving what is beyond your tithes. And this is the key to prosperity. We are going to accept this and put this in the Lordship of our Lord Jesus Christ, the blessing will flow in our lives. The blessing will just flow. Because the Bible says there is no enough room to receive it.
Amen.
Now the church is suffering, everything is suffering in the ministry. Because we are not following the commandment. But I'm challenging every one of us today. This is the time that you're going to remove the curse of it in your life. Let's make a milestone. Today is a milestone. I want everyone to be set free. Set free from the mind that I cannot give a tithe because it's not enough. Yes, it's really not enough. Every time it's not enough. It will not be enough. The money without the tithe will just run very near. Just very not enough. But when you give your tithe to the Lord, the lamp is holy, when the first fruit is holy.
Amen.
And it will go a long way.
Amen.
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 Today I want to challenge you. This is a challenge. We're going to a new place. I don't require more plates, flags, or anything that will go beyond the tithe. Just give what belongs to the Lord, and just give what offers your offering in love for the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And that will create a very, very powerful church. Amen.
Amen.
Lastly, the tithe is the strength of your blessing.
Amen.
Amen. That is the fence. That is the fence. Boundary wall.
Yeah,
it will cover you from the devourer. This is the fence. When you put the seed of your offering inside, then there's a fence of your tithe. Your offering will flourish, grow fold by fold by fold. But if your tithe, the boundary is 10%. If you give 50%, the fence is only half. Still, your blessing is open. The devourer can still go inside and devour your crops, your blessings. Give 10% for the Lord to fence your blessing. Give extra for your sin, and the blessing will be multiplied 100-fold, 1,000-fold.
Amen.
I have a very, testimony sa Sir Eva. One day, she told us that, Pastor, I want to give testimony. I told her, sis, there's no time. Pastor, I want to give testimony. Because that day, she already had the first salary of the new job that she received. And you know, the vow, that is a vow for the Lord. That she said that, Pastor or the church, you know, she said that if ever God will give me this job, first of my salary will be given to the church. The blessing just flow for her life. First salary, nothing less, nothing more. 100%. Amen. Kami do that. You cannot do that, you know. But the Lord is not telling you to give all of your salary. Just 10%.
Amen.
10%. Hallelujah.
Yes.
I want you to. This is a move. This is a step of faith right now. I want you to take something from your wallet. Do not allow this time to pass. If you did not receive your salary and your heart is not ready, don't do it. Because this is, will take up. No, this is about giving cheerfully. If you give with compulsion also, with angry heart, no, don't give. Keep it for money. Just allow them to run the business for glory and honor.
Amen.
Amen? So we have to. For those who want the curse to be broken in their lives, in their finances, I want you to just give something before the Lord. We all have to give our tithes, our offering before the Lord. For those who will receive the salary, it's your choice. And for those who will pay the salary in the next week, we have every Friday service, we have to give our tithes. In a church of grace, this is our law. Amen?
Amen.
We are in the Church of Grace, but the law is to give the tithes and offering. Amen?
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Let's give God a clap offering. Amen? Hallelujah. Amen.
Yeah.
prayed for this. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for today, Lord God, for opening our eyes, opening our hearts, oh God, to accept, Lord God, the teaching, Lord God, about giving, about tithing and offering. Lord, you have said in your word that you love a cheerful giver. You don't delight, Lord God, in those who give, Lord God, in compulsion with a heavy heart. Lord, even the woman, Lord God, who gave to Linda, Lord God, all that she has, compared to the one, Lord God, who gave, oh God, your money, Lord God, with a proud heart, oh God. You delight on the woman's heart, oh God, to give the less. And Father, today, Lord God, I pray, Lord God, that you continue, Lord God, to teach us, Lord God, to obey you. You are our God. You are our Lord. You are Master, oh God. We obey you, Lord God, in all aspects of our lives. And I pray, Father, today, Lord God, for this offering. Bless, Lord God, those hands who give, for the tithes, oh God, and the offering, oh God. I pray, Lord. You have promised, oh God, in your word, that you will allow and empower, oh God, to devour the blessings of that real people. Put a hands of protection, oh God, for all the blessings, oh God, and to be preserved, Lord God, for your glory and for your honor. Father, I pray, Lord God, for today, Lord, we pray for this place, Lord God, that we're going to live in this place, Lord. But we pray, Father, that you continue, Lord God, your presence to be here, Lord God.
Yes, Lord.
And we don't know in the future, Lord God. We just committed that to you, Lord God.
Yes, Lord.
For anybody or anyone, Lord God, who will use this place, it will be days of worship, days of your presence, Lord God.
Yes, Lord.
Continue, Lord, to use this place, Lord God. Bless the honor of this place, Lord God.
Yes, Lord.
We pray, Father God, for this management, Lord. Bless them. Church, oh God. Thank you for the manifestation of your Spirit. Thank you, Lord God, for the power of your word, oh God. I pray, Father, Lord, that continue, Lord God, to strengthen your people, oh God, and supply us, Lord God, with wisdom, supply us, Lord God, with the truth, Lord God. And Father, Lord, as we depart from this place, oh God, let your Holy Spirit guide us, protect us, Lord God, at all times, oh God. I pray, Father God, that Lord, your blessings, oh God, will also go with us, Lord God, wherever we go, whatever, Lord God, we will do. Father, preserve the lives of your people. Guide them, protect them, Lord God, in every, Lord God, endeavor of the Lord, everything that they are going to do, Lord God, throughout this week. Father, Lord God, I also pray, Lord God, for all the brethren, Lord God, who are sick, or sisters, Lord God, who are sick. Lord, I pray for your healing, Lord God, be upon them, Lord God. Lord, today, thank you, Lord God, for the mighty, mighty word, Lord God, that you have released to your people, Lord God.
Yes.
Let's all raise our hands. Now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. And all the people of God will say,
Amen.
God bless you.